everyone. My name is Catherine Liu. I'm a product manager in the Azure storage team working on ElasticSAN. I want to welcome you guys to our new skilling video where we will show you an ElasticSAN in action using some of our best practices. So the goal of this session is to set up and configure an ElasticSAN using some of our recommended configurations and show how we connect to an ElasticSAN volume and test our performance numbers. But before we head into the actual demos, I'm actually going to start with a refresher on ElasticSAN itself. So we are the industry's first fully managed storage area network offering in the cloud, and we offer a scalable, cost-effective, high-performance, and reliable storage solution. So we can connect to a variety of different Azure compute services, enabling customers to seamlessly lift and shift their SAN workloads to the cloud without having to change their provisioning and management model. So we support a resource hierarchy very similar to an on-premise SAN system, which you can visualize in our graphic right here. And just to kind of review what that looks like, we have our top-level ElasticSAN, and then underneath it, we've got our volume groups, which is a grouping concept to apply security, networking, and data protection configurations. Then within those actual volume groups, we have the actual volumes, which are the same data storage units as an on-premise system. So we support this data access to ElasticSAN volumes over iSCSI, which is a standard industry protocol widely adopted for different workloads. So both Linux and Windows have inbox drivers already installed to support connecting block storage over iSCSI. So one of the benefits of ElasticSAN that I mentioned is that we allow you to connect to a variety of compute options so you can integrate different workloads all in one ElasticSAN. We currently have three options available with ElasticSAN over iSCSI: Azure Virtual Machines, Azure Kubernetes Service, and Azure VMware Solution. Currently, our AVS solution is in public preview, just to kind of note. But I will go a little bit deeper into our VM option to showcase some of the benefits that we have. So part of today's demo, we're actually going to be demoing a connection to a virtual machine. But before I get into that, I just want to provide some details on how ElasticSAN workloads can actually run on VMs. So for today's example, we're looking at this particular VM configuration. We can see both the max IOPS and throughput for a disk scenario and an ElasticSAN scenario. Since VMs connect to ElasticSAN volumes over iSCSI, storage I/O uses VM network bandwidth, and the traditional disk throughput limits on a specific VM SKU don't actually apply to ElasticSAN. So if customers run into these scenarios where they normally have to upgrade their VM due to the disk throughput limits, for example, like running quarter-end reporting or during holiday periods where they need very high throughput, with ElasticSAN, they don't need to upgrade the VM. They can just drive higher storage throughput via VM network bandwidth as needed. And then the other benefit I wanted to highlight is our cost efficiency with storage consolidation and dynamic performance sharing. So basically how that works is, let's say you have an ElasticSAN with 100 terabytes provisioned on your base unit, which will give you about 500K IOPS. And then let's say underneath that, you've provisioned 100 1 terabyte volumes within that SAN. So each of those volumes can technically achieve a max of 80K IOPS, but collectively they can't go past that 500K IOPS, which is provisioned at that top SAN level. But let's jump into our example for today's demo. So let's meet John. John is a storage administrator who is testing his new ElasticSAN to ensure the performance will meet his workload and storage requirements. To accomplish his goal, he must configure his ElasticSAN networking to connect his volume to a VM to make use of that SAN. Then he can configure some of our best practices in both his SAN and the VM to ensure the performance numbers hit their provision target. But now let me walk you through the configuration steps for John's ElasticSAN. So let's start with networking. So in John's example, we first need to configure his networking on his target volume group. So we offer two networking options on the volume group level, VNetAccles and private endpoints. John will be configuring a private endpoint on this volume group, which, you know, the flow is just kind of listed here. And this can be done in the portal or via PowerShell CLI. But I also wanted to highlight some of our configuration best practices that I mentioned before. And we recommend you configure it this way to kind of hit our best performance, which you can review in more detail in our documentation. So to start, we want to ensure that our VM and our Elasticsearch are deployed in the same region and zone, and accelerated networking is enabled on that VM. And then lastly, we need to configure multipath IO and iSCSI initiator based on our recommended guidelines, which I will detail in our demo also. So moving on to our next task, which is connecting to the actual VM. So to read and write to the volume you have provisioned, you need to connect your volume from your compute resource. And this is the basic flow of how that connect experience kind of happens. But today I will demonstrate how to connect a volume from a Azure VM with a multi-session connect example. So let's take a look at a deployed SAN that John has already set up. And let's run through how we actually connect a volume from a client. So we've already set up our network access configurations during deployment. So as you can see here, I'm just going to show you which volume group we'll actually be using. And we can verify that the private endpoint is set up right here. So we've also already configured our VM. So for this test, we're using this particular VM size and this OS configuration. Our objective for this test is to achieve volume performance targets. So I picked this VM as the network bandwidth for this VM is higher than the volume throughput limit. But let's run through the actual connection steps that we can see with our volume. So we've got our volume set up here. We can connect one volume to a Windows client by establishing multiple sessions. So let's go ahead and walk through what this is actually doing. Our recommendation is to use 32 sessions to each volume to achieve the volume performance targets of 80,000 IOPS and 1,280 megabytes per second throughput. So one thing to note here is the volume performance scales at 750 IOPS per gigabyte and 60 megabits per second per gigabyte. So the volume needs to be about 110 gigabytes roughly to be able to achieve this max performance number. We've configured here in this example a 400 gigabyte volumes, and that's what we're going to use as this example. Keep in mind the overall performance of all volumes still needs to be within the SAN provisioned performance target. So in this case, a SAN is configured with a 30 base unit. So we've got enough performance provision at the SAN level for our 400 gigabyte volume. So our volume should be capable of achieving its max targets during our benchmarking tests for IOPS and throughput. So I'm going to go ahead and run you through this particular volume connection. So after we've selected the volume to connect, this generates a script, a PowerShell script that you can run on the client to establish the connectivity with the volume. So before going over to our VM to run it, I'm going to take a quick look at what exactly this script is doing. So we're using a Windows VM. So I've got the Windows script kind of pulled up here. So to connect the volume over iSCSI and to establish these multiple sessions, we need two kind of prerequisites that the script is checking for. So we need iSCSI initiator and multipath IO to be enabled. If you're not familiar with MPIO, it's basically necessary to aggregate all the sessions and paths to the volume into a single device, and it helps with path failover if needed and load balancing. So this script doesn't actually cover installing these two tools, but we have provided detailed instructions on how to install these tools in our documentation, which I will run through when we get to the connect. So this script first, like I mentioned, will kind of check for these two prerequisites. So it'll check for iSCSI initiator here, and then it will also check for multipath IO. If they are not there, it will notify the user so that they can exit the script and then install those things. So in this section, it's running a few iSCSI commands to actually add the volume as a target and then log into the target to establish 32 sessions. It will also establish persistent connectivity to that target volume. So if you wish to lower the number of sessions, you can update that line in here. So all of these details for the volume are kind of listed right here. And you can see we kind of hard set some of these things. So this is the 32 sessions that we're running. So let's go ahead and copy this script and move over to our VM. So now that we're in our Windows VM, before we run the multi-session connect script, we want to confirm that we have all of our recommended configurations set up. So as I mentioned before, as part of the connection setup, we need to initialize iSCSI initiator and install multipath IO and make sure those are installed with our recommended setting. So these scripts in our documentation to kind of run through the connect process will check for these things, and this is how we kind of install them. So I will go ahead and run these. So this first script is installing and making sure that iSCSI initiator is running. And as you can see, since this was already set up on my VM, it kind of confirms that it's already running. And then similarly, the multipath IO set of scripts we can run next. And it should also complete and tell you there's no change needed because we've already got this set up. But basically, just to kind of review, we are enabling multipath IO and then verifying that the installation was installed. And then the two recommended configurations that we also set with this installation process is enabling multipath support for iSCSI devices, and then setting our default load balancing policy to round robin, which is should be optimal for most workloads. And that's kind of what this script is doing. So now we are ready to connect to our volume. We can simply paste our connection script that we got from the portal. And after running it, we can see that all of the operations kind of completed successfully, but we do want to verify that 32 paths were actually created, which we can do with this script right here. So here we can see this is our disk that we just added. And let's verify and the number of the disk that we need to check, which is number 2. So if we run that script again with the specific disk number, so now that we ran that, we can verify that we've got our 32 paths. We can also see that this disk will show up in our disk management here. So from here, we can actually bring the disk online, format, and mount it. This disk has already been pre-mounted on the F drive right here. So now we can see our mounted volume. We can actually go ahead and run some basic benchmarking tests. So there are multiple tools that we have available to run these tests. The one we normally recommend for Windows is Disk Speed. And you can actually download it from our this GitHub link right here, which I'll kind of flash on the screen. To save some time today, I've already have it downloaded on this VM, but we can kind of go into the test that we're going to run. So for this example, let's say we're using this VM and Elastic Sand setup to run SQL reporting, which will be very throughput intensive. So we'll need to kind of run two tests to kind of verify these intensive workloads. So the first test we'll run on disk speed is to test the write IO for this workload. So for this test highlighted here, we'll start with a block size of 8K to simulate a random IO test with 64 threads. And we're, again, testing only write operations, which is kind of listed here. And then to explain the next test, we've got a throughput test. So what we want to do is increase the block size to 256K to test for maximum throughput. So I will go ahead and copy those here and run them. So once both of these tests are finished running, we can see our, let's start with our IO, IOPS test. So we tested just for write IO. So we'll kind of just look at this table here. So in this column, we'll see kind of the total IO per second that we're needing to hit. Just to reiterate our volume targets. Our volume targets right now are we're trying to hit a maximum of 80K IOPS and then this 1280 megabytes per second throughput. So as you can see here, our total IO, right, IO for this test is close to that 80K target. It's kind of floating around that margin. Sometimes you'll see kind of dips just due to throttling and things like that, but this is pretty close to our max IOP limit. And then similarly for our throughput tests, we can see our under our write IO, which is what we tested for, we're seeing a total megabyte per second at 1200, which is close to our target. So this test confirms that we're able to meet those two performance targets, which is definitely a high priority for this particular workload example that is throughput intensive. That basically wraps up our demo for today. So for more information on how to get started with ElasticSAN, feel free to visit our documentation for more information and to find some of the detailed steps to run through the demo for yourself. And if you have any questions or feedback regarding ElasticSAN, you can always contact us at the alias listed on the screen. So thank you so much for your time, and we hope to see you again in our next skilling video.